individual pathophysiological phenotype. And by doing so, we can then have a targeted precision medicine approach to individual phenotypes. And a really important distinction to take home is this one between right ventricular phenotypes and left ventricular dysfunction phenotypes. And the different approaches to management here. In those with a right ventricular dysfunction phenotype, our approach should be aggressive reductions in pulmonary vascular resistance, including the use of pulmonary vasodilators. These are likely to be the group who may benefit from these drugs. However, in those patients with a left ventricular dysfunction phenotype, our aim is to support the left ventricle, allow it time to recover, and to be very cautious about the use of pulmonary vasodilators, which may theoretically worsen the situation. So thank you very much for listening. I hope that that's been an interesting discussion for you, and I look forward to your comments. If you'd like to get in touch, my email is here, and I'd like to thank everybody who's been involved in our work. Thank you very much.
Can we connect Yasser, please? Dr. Yasser Said, please, with us.
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Hi, Dr. Yasser. Thank you for joining us. Dr. Yasser is currently in Paris. He's presenting in the fourth launch for point of care lung ultrasound. So thank you for joining us. And thank you for the amazing presentation indeed. We have
Thank you for the kind invitation. You are doing a wonderful job at the University of Anchams. So thank you for your kindness, Umaima, and the kind invitation from Dr. Hisham Awad and the organizing committee. It's really a great pleasure to join you today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. الحقيقة يعني احنا كمان تعقدنا بالجرافيكس والuse of يعني the way you use Vavishin to we understand the hemodynamic or what's the background of every type of shock. وكمان انا بأكد على كلام حضرتك انه the last paper about the ان احنا ناخد physiological approach for the management of shock. The last paper Dr. Yasser showed in the presentation. Please, انا عن نفسي البيبر دي انا معلقاها على الحيطة. Use it for every round. Diamond machine bill app of the blood pressure, and I always ask the trainees ululi ail systolic blood pressure with diastolic blood pressure with pulse blood pressure, what are the centiles with during the follow-up, whether we use inotropes, we don't use inotropes, and ababa arfa il progress bita al patient da, and when I need to interfere and when I need to avoid any kind of intervention. Thank you also very much for giving us also the opportunity nahna nafham izai how to manage biragm nahna ma andanash invasive blood pressure monitoring. And actually, للأسف إحنا ما بنعملش arterial invasive blood pressure. So it was very, very important that you showed us how to manage يعني using the trend of non-invasive blood pressure. That was extremely useful. I have a few questions from our trainees and our residents. So if you don't mind, if you can read some of them.
My pleasure. Yeah, I'm staying with you. Whatever questions you have, I'm happy to answer.
Thank you very much. One of the questions, what is the neonatal cerebral oxygen saturation? And probably she means what's the accepted cerebral saturation after autoregulation mechanism has happened. She mentioned in the case you presented, it was around 50 and then it rose after autoregulation to 70. So what's the accepted cerebral saturation?
Yeah, thank you very much. We have been using near field spectroscopy as part of our routine monitoring, not for every baby, only for sick babies. So we have five main categories that we can consider near field spectroscopy for brain monitoring. It's a kind of expensive technique, and it's cheaper now, but it doesn't make sense to use it for everyone unnecessarily. So we are using this technique for premature infants during postnatal transition. It means that premature infants less than 28 weeks, the premature infants expected with postnatal transition complications. And the transition means the first 3 days of life, which we consider that as a period of minimal handling. So near field spectroscopy can guide us when we should do the blood gases, blood sugar sometimes, because we may have the impact of these variables on the brain saturation and the brain metabolism, we can get that non-invasively through the near-field spectroscopy instead of poking and getting the blood gases every 4 or 6 hours in sick premature infants. So we consider that also for hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy. So we have a standardized neurocritical care monitoring for any near-term or term infant with HIE, either on cooling protocol or not on cooling due to contraindication. We monitor during the first 3 days of life until we start rewarming and get the MRI done. So we do near-field spectroscopy monitoring for the brain saturation, continuous monitoring of EEG or amplitude integrated EEG, and we assess ultrasound, brain ultrasound, and Doppler as well. Because sometimes you may get from the ultrasound before MRI unexpected brain hemorrhage or any other associated pathology, or not just assuming the underlying pathology could be HIE, related to HIE, but we have seen double hit of HIE and other things picked up by ultrasound early before MRI. We are also monitoring near-field spectroscopy for any infant, either term or preterm, with hemodynamic instability. So any infant requiring any hemodynamic or cardiovascular support beyond 5 to 10 mics of anything per kg per minute, because for that is unstable hemodynamics, we have to start monitoring the autoregulation by near-field spectroscopy. We also consider that for any infant with ventricular dilatation secondary to IVH in premature infant to detect the impact of hydrocephalus on brain circulation. So that's a routine assessment, and sometimes it guides us when we should consider reservoir shunt or shunt early before significant compression of the brain of the brain vascularity or hemodynamics. So these are the main indications. Also, one more indication, which is infant with hypoxemic respiratory failure, to guide weaning of oxygen. We are not relying only on pulse oximetry saturation for to guide oxygen titration. We use pulse oximetry and near-field spectroscopy together. So we are considering 60 to 80. What does that mean? So if this 60 to 80, it means the difference between the arterial saturation, which I assume to be 90 to 95, 60 to 80, the difference between both is how much consumed by the brain for, needed for metabolism. If you have the number is decreasing and below 50 is really low, it means that the brain is extracting too much oxygen to compensate for the decreased delivery. So low number brain oxygen saturation, it means that the autoregulation has been lost. If the autoregulation is still maintained and working, you will not see any difference on near-field spectroscopy. The number will be within the acceptable target. Once you see the number is decreasing, it means your autoregulation has been lost and the brain is extracting more oxygen to compensate for the low delivery. And then the next step, if you missed this window because you don't have the technology of near-field spectroscopy, you will get lactic acid in the blood gas. It means autoregulation has been lost and increased extraction has been exhausted. And now you are at the stage of anaerobic metabolism. It's too late. You are now just one step before irreversible shock or end organ damage, because lactic acid is usually associated with some sort of end organ damage. That's why we monitor early with the near-field spectroscopy to detect early, increased oxygen extraction or compromised autoregulation before development of lactic acidosis. If you don't have the technology, it's okay, but at least you need to monitor the other parameters of hemodynamics, including blood pressure, in a physiologic way, in a physiologic manner. Don't just look at the mean blood pressure equal to gestational age. That was 10 years ago kind of management in our unit. After we started the hemodynamics assessment, we are actually educating our nurses. Our the bedside nurse, she has a centile table and she refers to the physician at any deviation once we have the systolic or diastolic blood pressure outside the centile values. So we get that early from the bedside nurse and she continuously looking at the trend, monitor trend. Fortunately, we have the invasive monitoring, which is available for any sick infants, including premature babies. We just insert UVC, UAC as a routine after birth for any premature infants requiring mechanical ventilation. And then the bedside nurse will monitor and keep looking at the trend and just let us know if there is any deviation from the trend. So we'll get notified early about the blood pressure. again, systolic, diastolic, and pulse pressure. These are very important variables. Simply, if you have infant with the hypovolemic shock, you will get the compensatory mechanism of increased systemic vascular resistance. The mean blood pressure will stay normal. Once you see the mean blood pressure low, it is too late. You already, the infant even lost the compensatory mechanism that he made to compensate for low volume. So looking at the mean blood pressure is very limited. You will miss a lot of physiologic variables and will just pick up at a very late stage of decompensation.
Thank you very much, Yasser. There is another question.
Okay. Hello, Dr. Yasser. Some of our attendees are asking about the perfusion index. Some pulse oximetry devices measure the perfusion index.
Yes.
She's asking if it is a good, the bedside tool to assess the hemodynamic condition if there is no other tools to assess it.
Wonderful question. Thank you very much. Perfusion index, one of the underutilized variables for a long time. Most of the pulse oximetry monitors, regardless Philips or Massimo or whatever company, they have the perfusion index as a small number. I don't know why they made it a small number. That's why it's neglected by a lot of people. They don't like it because really they made it small on the corner. I don't know why, but it's really helpful. Why? The arterial oxygen saturation is perfusion dependent. So we cannot rely on arterial oxygen saturation number if the perfusion is below the acceptable level. That's why they made the numbers integrated. So if the perfusion, for example, if you have PI, perfusion index, below 0.4, which is the lowest number, then you cannot rely on oxygen saturation. The number will be just an artifact. You need to improve the perfusion. It's perfusion dependent arterial oxygen saturation. The other alternative way to detect, to get a blood gas, and you may see discrepancy between both. So the perfusion index, the same like any other parameter, it is a trend. You need to look at the trend. Generally, we consider 0.4, which has been published and validated in premature infants, between 0.4, just to make it a simple number. 2.7 will make it 3 as a simple number. So between 0.4 to 3 perfusion index, which is giving you the fraction of the palatine arterioles compared to non-palatine arterioles. So that's a mean of perfusion index. So they made index to palatine to non-palatine. So if you have less non-palatine arterioles, mean have poor perfusion. So 0.4 to 0.3, also high perfusion index might not be abnormal number, because when you have hyperdynamic circulation and vasodilator shock, you may have perfusion index of 5 or 6. And also in premature infants with inflammatory, like chronic inflammatory stages in chronic lung disease or with the PDA, because the PDA is shunt from left to right is not stable all the time. It is variable from time to time. You may have significant shunt in like when the pulmonary vascular resistance drop, if you increase the FiO2, the bedside nurse decrease the FiO2, the vascular resistance will increase and the shunt will be limited. So the shunt will be variable from time to time, and that will be reflected in the perfusion index. So one of our articles in collaboration with the, a fellow in Saudi Arabia, we published the perfusion index as histograms. So we come now to another mode of trend, which is histograms. I'm not sure if you are using pulse oximetry or arterial saturation histograms or not. We have been using that as a routine for a long time, because histograms is give you a 24 hours trend as percentage of trend if the saturation outside the acceptable values. It's the same for perfusion index and the blood pressure. Look at the histograms and look at the trend over time. So perfusion index is really helpful, especially if you use it as a trend.
So it is an important tool.
It's an important tool, but again, with the, like any other tool, with limitations. So yes, it is not a reliable tool only by itself.
Only by itself, yes.
Dr. Yasser, thanks a million for being with us and spending this your precious time trying to help us. I was wondering if you are using NERS as an indicator for the need for blood transfusion. It would be a good marker to indicate that the baby is in need. We do not have NERS up till now in our unit, but I'm thinking that if the extraction is, the baby is extracting too much, we can help the oxygen delivery by raising his hematocrit. Are you aware with anything like this?
Thank you very much, actually. This is a wonderful question. So it has been validated in acute anemia that using a fractional oxygen extraction of 0.4. So if you have the pulse oximetry and the near phase spectroscopy together, you can calculate what's called fractional oxygen extraction. So it is arterial oxygen saturation minus the brain oximetry divided by arterial oxygen saturation will give you a fraction. The fraction is number like a fraction of one. So normally between 0.15 to 0.33 in premature infants, that has been validated, and also the same number in adults. So when you have increased extraction due to any other reasons, with decreased blood flow or anemia or low oxygen saturation, the fraction oxygen extraction will be increased. So they have has been published or validated that using 0.4 fraction oxygen extraction as a cut limit to consider transfusion. It was actually not very strong study, but was one of the studies that based on physiologic understanding, because it makes sense if you have acute anemia, the oxygen extraction will be increased. Just I will mention one of the important limitations. It might not be very helpful in cases of chronic anemia. For example, chronic anemia prematurity. If you have infant chronic anemia of hemoglobin of 75 or 80, you may have normal near field spectroscopy because the infant exposed to low hemoglobin for a long time and the body already compensated by increased local nitric oxide at the tissue level. And that happens over a longer period of time and the tissue accommodated to get the oxygen consumption at that level of hemoglobin. So for the chronic anemia, it's not really helpful unless you have significantly low hemoglobin, like maybe 60 or so. But it has been validated in acute hemorrhage or acute anemia. When you have infant with fetal maternal transfusion born with low hemoglobin or internal hemorrhage, for example, it might be helpful.
Thank you, Dr. Yes.
My pleasure. We'll try to finish as much as possible. We know you promised us to have 30 minutes, so hopefully we'll be finishing on time. So just another question about infant of diabetic mother. You said the only thing is to give IV fluids, not to give inotropes. So what if the blood pressure is low as well? And is there any role for the beta blockers to use as well or not?
Yeah, wonderful question. Thank you very much. Yeah, that's a very good question. And again, I'm done with my presentation and my session. So I'm with you. If you have any more questions, up to your time. Regarding the infant of diabetic mother, we have to be very careful in these cases because using inotropes might be a disaster without doing echocardiography. So it is a routine for any IDM with hemodynamic instability to confirm by echo. So if you don't have a neonatologist expert in hemodynamics, alternative to ask a colleague from pediatric cardiology to assess by echo. The tricky part about low volume, as I mentioned, the compensatory mechanism from our body to increase the systemic vascular resistance. So we have the blood pressure maintained in most of these babies. You may not have a low blood pressure unless you have other underlying pathophysiology causing vasodilation. For example, use the morphine or any medication that might lower the blood pressure. So inotropes is contraindicated. You should not use any inotropes, either epinephrine or dopamine or dobutamine in these cases. If the blood pressure dropped, it means that the autoregulatory mechanism or the body compensation for increased vascular resistance has been lost. So help the body in the same way that the body cannot help itself by using vasopressors. I think there's someone trying to open the... Yeah, sorry. So to help the same way of the body trying to compensate by itself, so use vasopressors. So it happened in few cases that we use vasopressors. Nor epinephrine or vasopressin. Don't use any medication with beta stimulant, with dobutamine or dopamine. Typically, we are considering fluids. It's very important, fluids, and then if the heart rate is like close to 150 or higher, you need to slow the heart rate to give a chance for end diastolic filling. And you can get that by beta blockers. So that's really practical to do. And we have done that in many cases successfully. I can remember the last 5 years, maybe I can remember two or three cases required vasopressors. And probably you need just a low dose of vasopressors, like 0.1 or more epinephrine or low dose of vasopressin if we are using vasopressin, but no inotropes in IDM.
Thank you very much, Dr. Yasser. I would like to just welcome Dr. Neil Patel. Thank you very much for the amazing presentations. Actually, although they appear like they are two different subjects, but actually they are one subject and they are very intermingled together. And I think following this physiological approach and a sort of puzzle, I think I'm going to design some puzzles and try train, you know, ourselves, like, you know, how to fit things together if you have this or you have this parameter on. So thank you very much, Neil and Yasser. We have some questions for you. Meanwhile, I would like to ask you, probably both of you and Neil, like when we start, we are trying to be away from using dopamine completely. Are we going to hear, like, at some point, like, stop using dopamine? Should I say it like warning, no dopamine? And also the dose of dopamine. I can see, like, in both presentations, we are trying to limit also the use of dopamine, 5 to 10 micrograms. Don't go beyond that. So I would like really to hear from both of you, Neil, if you can, you know, tell us what's your point of view here.
Sure. Thank you very much, Amaima. It's a pleasure to join you all. And I think it's a really interesting question. In terms of are we ready to say stop, don't use them, I think that is a message that is starting to become established from the leaders in the field in the area of neonatal hemodynamics. And I think we have to look backwards to understand why we use these agents. Historically, they were the drugs that were the standard for treatment of hypotension in neonatology. And we have many years of established practice to try and overcome the use of them, I think. So I completely understand why people continue to use them. It's what we were taught to do, and it's what we're used to doing. We're familiar with these drugs. But as you said, we have to understand the puzzle a little bit better, and we have to look beyond the blood pressure at the underlying pathophysiology and base our treatment decisions on an understanding of what is happening in each of the ventricles, in both the pulmonary and the systemic circulation, and make informed choices and targeted choices of agents. And in some cases, in some situations of circulatory compromise, dopamine or dobutamine may be the correct agents. They may have the desired effects, but they're as I think is a strong message from both of our talks. There are clearly situations when they are not the appropriate agents. And if we have an understanding of the underlying pathophysiology, then we can understand why that might be. The doses, as you say, are also important. And again, I think that applies not just to dopamine and dobutamine, but to all of the agents that we use. Again, historically, we've sometimes all been guilty of a little bit of a more is better approach, where when the baby is failing to respond, rather than going back and trying to understand the pathophysiology and reassessing, we tend to just turn up what give more of what we're giving already. And I think we need to appreciate that the effect of the agents that we give, all of the agents that we give, is different in different patients and is different at different doses. And an understanding of those differential effects is important. As you say, personally, even in the situations where I might use dopamine or dobutamine based on the patient's pathophysiology, I tend to avoid them at higher doses. I'm always cautious above 10 micrograms per kilogram per minute because of the chronotropic effects of those drugs. And there's almost no situation where increasing the heart rate makes things better, I would say, unless you've got a patient in heart block, but then there are other drugs that we would use for that. So I hope that answers your question a little bit. I'd be interested in Yasser's perspective as well.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Neil. I really enjoyed your presentation. Welcome to the conference. This is very important questions. So day by day, we are getting evidence that dopamine is not really a good drug. And when when we published the article that I shared with you, we did a literature search and we found that there is significant evidence that dopamine is a drug that increases the oxygen consumption through the coronary circulation, increase brain oxygen consumption, in particular in premature infants, worsening the brain autoregulation, increase the overall body oxygen consumption, and increase pulmonary vascular resistance if there is underlying pulmonary hypertension. I may remind you to read the revised shock statement guidelines for adults. Just I'm talking about adults. The limited use of dopamine to 9 mics did not even reach double digit. So 9 mics is a maximum dose, and they prefer just to ignore it and use other specific medication like norepinephrine or specific inotropes. They said that if you use dopamine, don't exceed 9 mics. I'm talking about adult. So just imagine this really harsh medication that can be used and impact so many organs in premature infants. So in our new guidelines, we are not considering dopamine as a first medication anymore. We are specific. If there is vasodilator physiology, we are using norepinephrine as a first medication. If there is vasoconstrictor physiology, we are using dobutamine. And if we need to use a dual medication, we use epinephrine. Although epinephrine, there is some similarity between dopamine and epinephrine, but is not as complicated, associated with a lot of complications like dopamine. And we said that if we don't have options and we obligated to use it, don't exceed 10 mics per kg per minute. I would like to emphasize a very important point that you, like the most dangerous medication that we can ever use in neonates, cardiovascular medications. Playing with these medications might be the reason for decompensation and death at the end instead of helping. And in the past, we have seen babies, fortunately, we are not seeing that anymore. Babies started in dopamine up to 12, maybe 30 mics per kg per minute, and then dobutamine, and then adding epinephrine, sometimes maybe 4 medications. Fortunately, we are not, after implementation of the hemodynamics approach and understanding what's going on, adding medication over medication with higher doses might worsen the situation and help in development of irreversible shock instead of helping to reverse the shock back to the stable stage. And I can't forget a case that at the beginning of my fellowship, when I started to use echocardiography, we had infant to probably the last infant in my history, in my recall, was on dopamine of 20, dobutamine of 15, and epinephrine of 1 mics per kg per minute. That was 7 years ago. This infant, when we did the echocardiography, the heart was almost empty. There is almost the left ventricle is contracting and nothing. So that all of these inotropes will increase the systolic performance on expense of diastolic filling. So you have significant worsening of compliance of the heart by using all of this medication and to get the heart empty at the end. And the infant developed shock. And what I did for this case, I just turned it off everything. Because if we know what we are doing, I'm not scared to do that. Just at the bedside nurse, turn off the dobutamine, not even wean. Turn off the dopamine, turn off the dobutamine, and give fluids. And we can see at the same time that blood pressure is increasing, infant is recovered. And then within 2 hours, 0 medications, just given some fluids. Infant was intubated, very sick, HIE case, was being being discussed with the family for withdrawal of care. Second day after that, was extubated to CPAP and discharged after another week to home. So just to imagine how these medications can make a disaster. If you keep adding all of these medication over each other and you lost the ground, you don't know what actually the physiology that you are treating. So I just remind my colleagues, the most 3 bad interventions that might worsen any outcomes for any premature or even term infant: oxygen, cardiovascular medication, mechanical ventilation. So if you try as much as you can, avoid all of these things, you will get the better outcome.
Thank you, both professor, for your lectures. And what I would ask Dr. Neil, that we have last week, we have a patient, a newborn with a vein of Galen, and he has was the pulmonary blood pressure was 80, and he was has the PDA 2.5. The neurosurgery does not interfere except if the patient has an MRI. We don't able to transfer the patient because it was very bad joint condition and was ventilated. He took IV Lasix for the heart failure, and we start Minidone 0.25 for the pulmonary blood pressure. But unfortunately, the blood pressure, systemic blood pressure, become low. And we can't add fluid. We can't add, so we add, our cardiology advise us to add norepinephrine, and we add norepinephrine, and then the blood pressure much worse, and the patient was ventilated with FiO2 100%, and then we add telepresin, vasopressin, and unfortunately, the patient died.
Yeah, I think it's interesting to hear that you had a case of intracranial arteriovenous malformation, VGAM, just very recently, because it is a rare diagnosis. I'm not sure how often you've seen it, but relevant because of the case that I presented as well. And I think they are a very challenging circulation, because sometimes our approach has to be a little bit contradictory to what we might have historically targeted. Because the first reason is that the pulmonary hypertension is a pulmonary hypertension driven by increased pulmonary blood flow because of the high output cardiac failure. And there is a tendency when we have any form of pulmonary hypertension to use pulmonary vasodilators. But I don't think anybody is clear as to whether pulmonary vasodilators actually are beneficial in vein of Galen malformation. Personally, I think that theoretically they make the situation worse, because they can just promote increased pulmonary blood flow and therefore exacerbate the high output cardiac failure. So instead, in the short term situation, for me, the priority is to try and promote systemic blood flow. Now, that is difficult because the path of least resistance is through the head, through the vein of Galen malformation. So anything that we do has to try and lower the systemic vascular resistance in the rest of the body to try and promote blood flow to the lower part of the body, to the liver, which otherwise starts to show significant liver dysfunction and generalized metabolic acidosis. So in our own experience to stabilize those babies, we've had the approach of using systemic vasodilators. So like yourselves, we would use milrinone, but we've also used sodium nitroprusside, which is a potent systemic vasodilator. And the intention there is to increase systemic blood flow by lowering systemic vascular resistance. But the payoff is that the blood pressure may be low, as I think you experienced in this patient as well. And to some extent, we have had a permissive approach to systemic hypotension in these patients, because we know that although the blood pressure is low, we hopefully have got improved systemic blood flow and therefore systemic oxygen delivery. But that can only be used even in the short term as a stabilizing measure. Ultimately, the patient, if they're able, needs to progress to a definitive management, including embolization. And like yourselves, our approach has always been to get an MRI before we do that, because unfortunately, some patients will already have extensive infarction and parenchymal injury, which will prevent them even going, you know, down the path of embolization. But in the short term, in terms of stabilization, our approach has been one of systemic vasodilatation, permissive hypotension, as long as that systemic hypotension is allowing improved systemic blood flow and systemic oxygen delivery. But it's a temporizing measure until definitive management can be performed. We've used the same approach in other systemic AVMs, patients who have arteriovenous malformations in the liver, usually not as severely affected. It's the intracranial ones that usually give the very severe high output cardiac states immediately after birth.
Okay, I have two questions asking about the same thing, the preductal and postductal saturation. Some NICUs in Egypt don't have echocardiography, and if they are suspecting that the patient has pulmonary hypertension, sometimes they rely on the difference between the pre and postductal saturation. Is this is valid for you or not, Dr. Neil?
Okay, thank you. I suppose the first important point is that absolutely functional echocardiography is important in hemodynamic assessment and targeted management. But even in the absence of echocardiography, I think applying this pathophysiology-based approach is the most important point. And if we don't have an echo, we need to think about how we use our other clinical parameters to help us discern the relative state of the systemic and pulmonary circulations and of the cardiac function. Specifically the pre-postductal saturation as an assessment of pulmonary hypertension, I think it is potentially useful, but and we all use it clinically, there's no question. But it's important to appreciate that we will only see that there are two requisites to give us a pre-postductal difference. The first, of course, is that the ductus has to be open. And the second is that we will only see a difference when the pulmonary artery pressure is equal to or greater than systemic, roughly speaking. So we can still have significant pulmonary hypertension with an elevated pulmonary artery pressure, but if it's below systemic pressure, then there won't be significant shunting and we won't see a difference. The third factor that I would remind you about is that when we use oxygen saturation assessment, there is a degree of error within the assessment. If you ask a medical physicist, they will say, 5 to 10% can be normal. And not infrequently in our own neonatal unit, staff will say to me, oh, this patient has got a gap, between their pre and postductal saturations. Then we do the echo and the duct is closed. So we say, well, that's not a gap due to shunting. It's probably reflecting a degree of measurement error in the saturation device itself. So you have to take all of those factors into account. But nevertheless, if you're consistently seeing a significant gap of more than 10% in a patient who you think has other clinical features of pulmonary hypertension, then I think it can be a relatively useful indicator in the absence of an echocardiogram. So I'm not throwing it out altogether, but I'm saying think about those limitations before interpreting it too much.
Okay.
May I just add a comment regarding the vein of Galen malformation, which is a really important question, if you will let me, Nell, to comment on what you said. For vein of Galen malformation, as Nell said, it is the pulmonary hypertension in this case is not basically because of increased pulmonary vascular resistance, because we have two different pathophysiology. When you have pulmonary hypertension, it might be associated with high pulmonary blood flow. So adding nitric oxide or medication, pulmonary vasodilator, actually might worsen the situation, although nitric oxide, pulmonary vasodilator, might be used in a limited situation when you have severe hypoxemia and vein of Galen malformation, but it's not the first medication. So the pathophysiology in this case is high pulmonary flooding of the lung with more blood. So using pulmonary vasodilator does not make sense as a rescue medication for that. Typically, as Neil said, we are using dobutamine or merinone as to lower the systemic vascular resistance, keep the mean air pressure optimum, and we have a score to consider early interventions. So we are not just waiting long time until we get the time for embolization. I would invite you, just to speak of time, to review two articles. So we have published two articles in management of vein of Galen malformation. One of them, I published this article in collaboration with Patrick McNamara and Rieken Kissinger, the team from University of Iowa. And it is described how to manage the case of vein of Galen malformation during postnatal transition. And we have a protocol, very specific protocol, when you should consider each line of management, including pulmonary vasodilator in very limited indications. And I published another article with another group in Oman, like there were like three fellows with us in Manitoba, and they left Oman, and we published like the experience in Gulf area about management of vein of galen pre and post and during embolization. So you have infant going for the technique itself, how to stabilize during embolization, how to stabilize hemodynamics and support. So if you would like to get the articles, I can maybe share them with Umayma, and you can share both of them with the group. But if you PubMed my last name, you can get both of articles. And they are very detailed about management during early postnatal transition and also during embolization. Thank you.
I would like to thank you, Professor Nair, for your nice talk. I would like to ask again about the baby with vein of galen malformation. I think in this condition, what's killing is heart failure, and the heart failure is due to high cardiac output failure. So any pulmonary vasodilator will worsen things. And maybe we can resort to pulmonary vasoconstriction. Let's say the terminology of chemical banding. That's to say maintaining the CO2 a little bit high, maintaining the oxygen saturation a little bit low within the range of normal in the low value, so that to increase further the pulmonary blood pressure and to decrease the burden of the heart on the heart. What do you think about this?
Yeah, I think that's an important concept. First of all, not to pulmonary vasodilate in these patients, as Yasser emphasized. And then, as you say, to use whatever approaches we can to medically restrict the excessive pulmonary blood flow. And I agree, ventilatory adjustments are important to do that, including a degree of permissive hypercapnia and a higher PEEP as well. Ultimately, in my experience, in that initial transitional period, the challenge is one of hypoxic multi-organ failure and trying to ensure adequate systemic blood flow. So whilst I agree with you that the approach of trying to restrict excessive pulmonary blood flow is important, at the same time, it's about balancing the circulation and promoting systemic blood flow. Unfortunately, the one thing that we cannot medically, influence is the flow through the AVM, and that is the biggest challenge in this condition. So I would agree with Yasser's point that what we want to do is stabilize these patients as quickly as possible for embolization, accepting that there's only so much that we can do medically. And that ultimately the definitive management is going to be that interventional approach to the vein of Galen malformation. The other thing that's quite interesting in these patients is that the physiology can be quite different depending on the presence or absence of a patent ductus. And when we first reported the hemodynamics of these babies, we were struck at the difference, particularly in ventricular outputs, between the patients who had a patent ductus and who didn't. Clearly the ones who have a patent ductus, right ventricular output can be a lot higher than left ventricular output. And the case that I showed was a patient with a patent ductus. So I think you also have to think about the contribution of the ductus to the pathophysiology in these patients as well. I wouldn't be looking to close the ductus for that reason, but I think you have to be aware of its contribution to the physiology.
Thank you.
Yeah, like I would like to just comment on what you said, Neil. Sometimes we add prostaglandin in some cases to open the ductus. So it's not only like trying to close the ductus because it might be a valve just to relieve the pressure, the high pulmonary blood flow. And these cases very common to be associated with low systemic blood flow as well. That's why we aim to optimize or decrease the systemic vascular resistance by adding Merinone. In some situation, we may consider opening the ductus by using prostaglandin. Regarding the point that you said, Dr. Hisham, sometimes you are using low target saturation around 85 to aiming to increase the pulmonary vascular resistance, but we do that with near field spectroscopy. There's some limitation, as you know, with the pulse oximetry, because the number that you see in pulse oximetry is a standard deviation. So the number can be anything between 3 above or 3 below. So for safety in our unit, because like 85 might be 81 or 82, we are using near field spectroscopy once we accept the lower target saturation for kind of safety in these cases.
Thank you very much. Actually, you came to the end of our conference, and I think I would like to probably say what Patrick Nomura has said in one of his webinars, like we are as good as what information, how much information we have. And I think the information that we have now are very good. And thank you. You are a great resources, both of you. And I think you are shaping the practice of neonatology across the world. And we are learning definitely from you. And hopefully also we are improving, and we'll have here our integrated hemodynamic units. We have a great cardiologist, and we will work together to build really a hemodynamic assessment unit. Thank you very much for joining us. And thank you for everything you do for the neonatologists all over the world. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you for the kind invitation again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Neil, so much. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Yeah, enjoy you all the rest of your day. Goodbye.
Thank you.
احنا وصلنا لنهاية الماراثون بتاعنا.